Finally tonight, the gift of poetry over 100 years in a conversation we recorded recently with poet and editor Christian Wiman. Print the best poetry written today in whatever style, genre, or approach. The ambitious words written 100 years ago by Harriet Monroe when she founded Poetry, now the oldest monthly journal devoted to verse in the English-speaking language. Along the way, it's introduced such seminal figures as Ezra Pound and T.S. Eliot, and has championed poets from Wallace Stevens to Gwendolyn Brooks to former poet laureate Kay Ryan. In 2003, Poetry received a large grant from philanthropist Ruth Lilly that led to the creation of the Poetry Foundation, which funds projects to support the art, including the NewsHour's coverage. And to mark the anniversary, now comes a new book, The Open Door, 100 Poems, 100 Years of Poetry Magazine. With me now is Christian Wiman, the magazine's editor, and himself a highly regarded poet. And welcome, Chris.
Thanks for having me.
This is not a greatest hits of Poetry magazine. What were you and co-editor Don Scher after?
You know, we wanted to make a book that did a couple of things. It represented the magazine's history so that it had some of these high water moments like the love song of J. Alfred Prufrock or the Shield of Achilles by W.H. Auden. But it also represented the sort of the living history of the magazine where we're reading 140,000 submissions a year and choosing from among the best of them.
140,000 a year. I saw you wrote that in the introduction.
Right.
And I went, oh my goodness.
Right. And so we're looking for, you know, we're looking for unexpected pieces by the recognizably great poets, but also, and even more so, standout pieces by young poets. And we wanted the anthology to really represent that.
You know, in the introduction you have a line, I'll quote it, "One of the qualities essential to being good at reading poetry is also one of the qualities essential to being good at life, a capacity for surprise." Now here you are as the editor getting all of these and you're reading poetry. What does surprise mean to you when you're reading a poem?
You know, I think it's usually first a quality of language. I mean, it's something, it's some sort of signature language that you notice. But it's easy to get sort of sidetracked with that. You need that in a poem, but even more than that, you've got to have some sort of emotional engine running the thing. And so it's those two things. You're surprised on the level of technique, and yet you're surprised on the level of your heart. You respond to it.
Is there an example you can think of from when you were going culling through all of these 100 years?
Oh, every poem in the book.
I guess, by definition, what
pops into mind, you know, two poems immediately pop into mind. There was one by Thomas Dish, who died a few years ago, and he wrote a poem. I forget the title, but it's about, he uses words like terror and civilization and words that we hear in the news all the time now, but he wrote this poem in the 70s. And that poem was a real surprise for the way it seemed to anticipate things that we're talking about now. There was another by a young poet, one that we wanted to include several young poets. And there's a young poet out in California named Maria Hummel. And she wrote a very beautiful spare poem about having a sick child, a seriously ill child, and taking care of that child. And it showed the way that you could just use very plain language to bring across this very complicated, tragic situation.
When you're talking about the writing of poetry, and again, I'm referring to your introduction, you do emphasize language, you emphasize craft. You also emphasize a kind of moral quality, I think, to writing poetry. What did you learn about the writing of poetry, from going back and looking at all of this work?
Well, there's a famous quote from Ezra Pound, who was the foreign correspondent for Poetry magazine for years, and Ezra Pound said technique is the test of a man's sincerity. And I think that surprises some people because they think if you are spending too much time concentrating on the technique of an art, then you're losing sort of the feeling that's behind it. A lot of students think that you're squelching my voice if you make me learn to write in these other ways. But I think anytime you spend a long time with poetry, what you learn is that anyone who doesn't make those technical decisions part of their emotional life, where you can't feel their emotional life in those technical decisions, is not really writing poetry that's going to last. And I think that's what we saw throughout 100 years, is the poems that lasted had some real concentration with the formal elements of the art, some obsession with it almost.
You also said, I think, I forget the quote here, but something about if you can paraphrase a poem, it's not a poem. If you can just tell me what it is in a sentence or a phrase.
There's a similarity to dreams in that regard. You know, we make a lot about interpreting our own dreams, but there's always something a little reductive about that. You know, you have a dream and it seems to tell you something, and then you figure it out and you think, well, I figured it out. The same is true of poems. You've got a great poem and we ask kids to tell us what it means. Mm-hmm. And there's always an element of disappointment, I find, because a poem is, W.H. Auden said, a poem is the clear expression of mixed feelings. and I think we need some way in our lives to inhabit these parts of our lives that are not clear. That aren't black or white or one way or the other, and poetry can give us that.
Well, this long-running question, which you and sometimes tired question of the role of poetry in our culture, your answer seems to be it's something like that. Who knows in what ways poetry seeps into all of our lives?
Yeah, I think there are actually a couple answers to that question. I mean, if you look at the metrics, poetry is actually poetry's presence in American culture is increasing. You see it on the NewsHour, for instance. You hear it on the radio. You come across it on the internet, which I think is actually a great boon to poetry.
And I remember talking to Philip Levine, a recent poet laureate, and he was talking about the number of poetry readings. He said you can't take a walk without tripping over one,
right,
as opposed to when he was a young
right,
man.
Right, right. It's enormous.
Yeah.
It's, on the other hand, it's, you know, a country of, 350 million people or whatever, and it is a small percentage of that population that actually reads poetry. I think, however, that poetry is influencing the culture in ways that we don't see, in the way that other arts are as well, and that it tends to enter our lives and the lives of people, even people who don't pay attention to it, in ways that we're not always aware of. And I talk about that some in the introduction.
And that more than 100,000 submissions suggest that certainly a lot of people are writing poetry.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
And a lot of poetry.
Yeah. Well, I think it's, you know, you, I think it's actually, you may not get people to admit that they're writing poetry, but I mean, the number of people who write poetry secretly and don't show it to anybody is enormous. I meet people all the time who have, they don't even want to show it to me. They just want to talk about the act of having written something. And I think it's embedded in our genes. You know, we don't know of a culture that doesn't have a poetry, and it just has such roots that they're not going to be torn out.
All right, we're going to continue this conversation online, and I hope our viewers will join us there. But for now, Christian Wiman, thanks for talking to us about The Open Door, 100 Poems, 100 Years of Poetry Magazine.
Thanks for having me.
And there is indeed more of our conversation about Christian Wiman's own poetry and his latest book, Every Riven Thing. That's on our poetry page.